France. It's French. It's feminine. It'll help you grab one of those rotten, stinking men. Cabot for France.
Hey, here. Please. You know, you were fine this morning. Something happened at lunch.
My frog turned on me.
Yeah, I had some bad tuna myself.
As always, I'm Lindsay Wilkins. And this week, it'll be a soft launch of sorts for a series, me and Bede, who's a spoiler, is here, called Twinning Titles, which will maybe happen about once a month, where we look at a double where only they have the title in common. This week, it's not exactly a twinning title, but it was too good a double to pass up. It is Rob Hedden's Jason Takes Manhattan and Frank Oz's Muppets Take Manhattan. Of course, here with me, as I spoiled the lead, he's going to be coming on hopefully every once a month, depending on how quickly he gets sick of this. He is the co-head of and on all the amazing Super Network. God, this is why I should write things down. Super Network shows, as well as his own Bede versus the Living Dead. It is, of course, Bede Jermaine. Hey, how's it going?
I'm good, thanks, Lindsay. How are you?
I am good. No, I'm very excited for this. And we've been we've got so many titles that it's going to be too many to do. But I'm really looking forward to getting into this and kind of melding these doubles together.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Like, I'm excited for this series that you and I are teaming up for over the next year, because I think we have a very interesting list of movies that have very similar titles or the exact same title, but are completely different in terms of their genres and all that. And I think you and I are even talking about even more beforehand. So it's going to be an interesting one, like which ones out of all these films we end up recording.
It will be interesting because it's a long list, longer than I thought. But also, we are not alone as well, because we have she is more than welcome. Well, she's always welcome to come on the show anytime she wants. She just needs to flick me a message and go, hey, do you want to record? And I will say, yes. Yes, Marcy, I do. It is, of course, the other head of the Super Network and also After Dark. It is, of course, the amazing Super Marcy. Hey, how's it going?
Hello, hello. Thank you for a lovely introduction. And I'm doing well. I'm very excited for this episode's double feature, as well as the future ones for twinning titles. And hopefully I will join in on a few of those as well.
Definitely.
Definitely. We hope you do. So some of the titles, like there's a couple of them like going, that's not even the same language or even the same, same genre, like absolute extreme horror with a romantic comedy. I'm like, going, oh my God, they have the same. Yeah, we're doing that one. But no, thank you so much for Marcy to jumping on, because this is going to be such a fun double, especially watching them and going, huh, these are actually way more similar than I thought they were going to be.
I was thinking the exact same thing, and they kind of start off strangely the same way too, which we will get to when we talk about both. But yeah, I mean, I just randomly, just reason I picked these two films together is like, I think I was watching like a video on the Muppet Babies, and they were talking about how they originally kind of started off in The Muppets Take Manhattan. And then as a joke in the video, they kept like showing scenes from Muppets Take Manhattan, but then they were crossed over to scenes from Jason Takes Manhattan. So that's where the original idea, I thought, you know, I think this would be an interesting double feature for Lindsay and Marcy to do for your show, Lindsay. So that's why I suggested it. And then it kind of just spiraled from there.
It did. It really did. It just spiraled completely out of control. But no, this was a really fun double to watch, because you're just watching it two completely different style of filmmaking, completely different everything like that. And you just see, especially the reason why I was connecting it with Miss Piggy, because we'll get to that queen and what she does in Manhattan very, very soon. you guys have been absolutely busy as always. I mean, 2B Tuesday is going absolutely strong as usual. Bede was just telling me about his Christmas challenge, and you guys are almost, you've already put the vote out for the Christmas commentary this year. So everything is happening over at the Super Network.
Indeed it is. Well, hopefully, scheduling and illnesses and health don't get in the way too much going forward. It just seems to always be happening, but we always have things in the works. It's just a matter of getting it done.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes, and particularly Melbourne at the moment can't decide if it wants to be hot or cold, so it's just doing both at the same time, which if you don't believe that can't happen, come to Melbourne at the moment because it's weird. With that, we might as well get into it. This is just going to be the usual format with trailers and everything like that. So as I like to imagine, we are sitting in my own personal theater, the curtains about to open, and Marcy, since I know what you're going to do for a trailer and I'm very excited, let's start with you. What is going to be your trailer for Jason Takes Manhattan?
Yeah, literally the first movie that came to mind was Scream 6. So yes, that's pretty much why I picked it.
I had this secret. There's a darkness inside of me. It followed me here. And it's going to keep coming for us. We share a certain history. This isn't like any other ghost face.
What is this place?
A shrine.
We've got to lure him in.
We execute him.
Hello.
Let's play a game.
You know you're like the 10th guy to try this, right? It never works out for the dipshit in the mask.
Maybe. But there's never been one like me, Gale. I'm something different.
That's why I'm going to shoot you in the head.
Because Scream 6 actually does take place in the city, unlike Jason Takes Manhattan. So I figured, you know what? It's a recent one. It takes place in the city. They actually moved, I guess, the setting into a city for the Scream series. I did pick this a few weeks ago, and since then, the future of the Scream series is very shitty right now, which, yeah, it is what it is. But I quite enjoyed Scream 6. And, yeah, after rewatching Jason Takes Manhattan, I think it would work quite well. Even yes, though one is clearly in the city more than the other.
Well, yes, but more importantly, Jason Takes Manhattan was at the city, so that were technically filmed in Vancouver, I want to say, or Toronto, I think Vancouver, where there's Scream 6 was filmed in Montreal. Neither of them were one shot, a couple of shots in New York in Friday the 13th Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, might as well say the full title. But yeah, that was kind of my thinking. It was like, well, they're both filmed in Canada pretending to be New York. But yeah, the thing I love about Jason Takes Manhattan is that only very little of it happens in the
film. Yeah. At least with Scream 6, like, it might not have like all been filmed there or whatever, but at least you get the feeling you're in a city.
Yes.
So I do love that.
I do love it. I do love the opening sequence to Scream 6. I think it's really inventive. It just kind of keeps upping the ante. But when Samara Weaving's walking down that alleyway, even in modern New York, I'm like, even now, New York alleyways are not that pretty and that wide and that kind of, I don't know, there seems to be a whole lot of room in that alleyway. They're trying to gunge it up a little bit. I'm like, this is Canada. But it is, I mean, the bodega scene is really amazing. There's so many scenes of how it just kind of fits into how a ghost face would operate in New York. I absolutely love it. No, I do love it. I don't know if specifically Manhattan, he wouldn't call him Scarface. No, Ghostface would have a secret hideout or evil Leah, but I do actually enjoy that in the movie.
Yeah, and they both movies do have subway scenes as well.
Yes,
so
yes.
There's a little bit of that. They try to add in a few things, but I just found Scream 6 was just a fun film. Bede, what about you for this pick?
Indeed. Well, let's just face it, even though the movie is called Jason Takes Manhattan, he doesn't really get to New York until at least literally an hour into the movie.
It's Jason on a boat, or Jason goes boating. That is what the movie, yeah.
Jason exactly. on a cruise for an
Spoilers.
Hour.
Spoilers, yeah.
Exactly. So basically, you know what? I had to think about this for a trailer, and I wanted to pick something where it is set on a boat, but it's also a slasher. So for my trailer pick, I am going with the peak of Australian cinema, Houseboat Horror.
There's been some terrible things happening here. A fire. My little brother was killed. Terrible. I don't know why film people have to cause so much trouble.
Houseboat Horror. Australia's first made-for-video horror spectacle, where a rock and roll band and film crew meet their demise, one by one. By knife, by axe, by machete, by harpoon, by horseshoe, by scenic Lake Infinity, featuring Australian television's cream of the crop getting chopped, including Alan Dale, Gavin Wood, Animal, Louise Siverson, John Michael Housen, Christine Jeston.
Yeah, boy.
I still haven't cracked open my my umbrella. Is it umbrella?
Yes.
Blu-ray.
Yes.
It was umbrella. Oh, yes.
Yes. It's still sitting in my shelf wrapped. So I still have not seen this, but by legend, this is one of the most notorious Australian horror movies ever to exist.
Indeed.
Tell us a little bit about Houseboat Horror.
Well, I guess, Houseboat Horror is interesting because it was made in 1989 and it is a shot-on-video slasher film. And pretty much the idea is about a bunch of filmmakers who are going to this lake to shoot a music video with this band. And once they get there, and they do take houseboats to on the lake and also to an island to shoot the music video, and from there they get stalked and killed by a slasher killer. But the thing is, though, this movie is quintessentially very Aussie in so many ways. There's a lot of Australian actors who just pop up through it, including Alan Dale, right, yes. Marcy, from Neighbours, and also from other things as well over the years. And also it features music from Brian Maddox of the band Uncanny X-Men as well. And this movie is, I'm not going to say it's the greatest movie ever made, but it is the greatest movie ever made.
It is a fun movie.
Even on the... yes, because the reason why I keep talking about my Blu-ray is because when I was hanging out with these two lovely people at a movie bazaar, we were at the umbrella table, and all of a sudden, and also Andrew Shaw was there as well, so he is fully to blame. Mm-hmm. I kept hearing, I was looking at it going, oh, yeah, Houseboat Horror. And I heard this, get it, buy it, go on, Lindsay, buy it. And before you know it, I'm handing over way too much money for Houseboat Horror, and now I have it. And then my partner was like, what is that? I'm like, don't look at it. You don't ignore it. Just don't notice what I spent on
and that day. Mind you, it wasn't just the regular Blu-ray of this movie.
No, it was
the special limited edition version.
Yes, it was that as well. But there are more similarities, though, because there is a little bit of a music video shoot in Jason Takes Manhattan.
There is. I was thinking
of a very funky purple electric guitar.
Yes. And also a scarred, a deformed slasher killer as well. And also the killer has also a mother too in some way. So.
Oh, I'm looking forward to this. Because even on the thing, it goes, you know, Australia's, I think there is a thing for credit going with the worst Australian movie ever made, which it wears with pride. So I am very much looking forward to digging into this.
Indeed.
Well, after seeing an Australian movie called Plug, Houseboat Horror is not the worst Australian movie ever made.
I almost forgot about that movie and I was happy.
I'm sorry to ruin your happiness.
Oh, no, don't ever watch. No, don't even think it's going to be bad.
Marcy, you gave Lindsay Vietnam flashbacks right about now.
Yes, you did.
I gave myself the flashbacks by mentioning
you did.
It.
You did.
But Lindsay, what is your trailer for the movie?
Well, I'm actually going to change my mind because I was going to go for one thing that had a boat, but I think I'm going to go for something that has toxic ooze or radioactive ooze, which seems to be just all around New York in Jason's world. 1989 New York apparently was just littered with barrel drums of toxic waste. So I am going to go for the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles from 1990.
Our family grows. The city itself will be our playground to use as we please, rewarding ourselves and punishing our enemies.
We've been looking for you, Miss O'Neill.
There is a new enemy, freaks of nature. Together, we will punish these creatures.
What the heck was that?
Looked like sort of a big turtle in a trench coat.
I love being a turtle!
And this movie is actually awesome. Actually, this will also tie in nicely with Muppets Take Manhattan because Jim Henson's company did the design and the puppetry and the costumes of the actual Ninja Turtles, which is why they still look kind of awesome. And yeah, this movie's actually really good. I don't think any other Ninja Turtles... Actually, no, because I'm more nostalgic for that one, but I think Mutant Mayhem comes close. But yeah, nothing's beaten this movie. It is weird. It is thing. April, you're wondering if a turtle's going to screw April O'Neil, and for some reason you might be fine with it. I don't know. It is just kind of a delightful, creepy-ass, berserk movie where they got the guys from, I can't remember, the Chinese studio. Is it Red Harvest?
Golden Harvest, yeah.
Golden Harvest, thank you. To come in and actually do a lot of the stunt work. So it is an incredible kind of mashup of a movie that shouldn't exist the way it does, but for some reason it does, and I think the world is a better place for it.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Actually, that is a good pick because I think what's interesting about Ninja, the original 1990 Ninja Turtles film, because like Scream 6 and Jason Takes Manhattan, it also wasn't shot in New York. I think it was actually shot in Kentucky, I think, from what I remember. I could be wrong. So.
It's really weird. It does actually feel a little bit more New York than Jason will inevitably do. But I think just everything went right. I mean, but this also has weird secret hideouts. And when I look at the Foot Clan's like kids area, I was just like, actually, I would join the Foot Clan just so I could hang out there. That looks amazing. Right? It's got, like, Sam Rockwell handing out cigarettes. Yeah, it looks very cool.
I think what's also interesting, though, because between Ninja Turtles and Jason Takes Manhattan is like, they kind of really, even though, yes, they're not shot in New York, they kind of capture what New York was like at the time, because I always keep forgetting every time I go back to the original Ninja Turtles film is how dark and gritty of a film it is. Like, and it really is kind of captures how grimy New York was at that time in the 70s and 80s as well.
Yeah, by the time these movies are getting made, I mean, if you ever go back and watch Home Alone 2, it does the same thing. Like, New York is almost this hellscape. And I think there definitely were still parts of it that were really rough and underdeveloped and needed more infrastructure. Definitely that. But by the late 80s, early 90s, it was starting to come out of it. But if you ever watch a movie from, another movie I was thinking of as a trailer, something like The New York Ripper from 1982, our beloved Lucio Fulci. Yeah, New York is just disgusting. And he was just walking around with a camera, and though he'd walk around 42nd Street, and I'm just looking at the marquees going, can I see those movies? I want to see all those movies.
Or even something, another film I was thinking for a trailer, Maniac Cop is another one.
Yes.
As well.
Mm. Yeah, that definitely does that. So, yeah, you're right. Even though I think as we get into Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, I love how the titles just get longer and longer until they just yes. realize that. That's great. Jason goes to hell. Jason in space. Kind of exaggerates the idea of it, but it's instantly recognizable of what you think New York was at that time, which was everyone's on drugs. There are barrels of toxic waste for some reason. Everything's very dark, very creepy, and very kind of like you're in the middle of the Warriors or something. So it does definitely capture that. But that is only the last 40 minutes of this movie, because most of it, Jason's on a boat.
Yeah. For most of this movie, we're on a boat, whether we like it or not.
I kind of like it.
I mean, would Jason really be on a boat?
He does spend a lot of... okay, here's the thing. Jason's meant to hate water. I don't think he does. I think they just...
I think he hates drowning more than water. Yes. So.
No, actually, watching it this time around, I realized that this is probably the most aware Friday the 13th movie that has been made up to this point. I know Six is kind of very self-aware, but they're already making Jason wakes up whenever someone has sex above him. Someone, there's something referenced. They reference something. I cannot remember. I didn't write enough notes. Where I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, they're referencing that when Jason takes off his thing to the youths in Times Square, and then they're like, okay, we're sorry, sir. Yeah, it feels very self-referential. That's the guy. The guy on the boat who's meant to be Crazy Ralph. And I'm like, no, you just can't put a guy saying we're doomed. You have to actually set up Crazy Ralph so you understand that there's a lunatic saying we're doomed, and then bike with amazing posture down the street for 5 minutes as you watch him go, like he does in the first one or the second one. But yeah, it's got all those kind of elements that I'm like, okay, now they're just pointing at themselves now quite a bit.
And this one leans really heavily into Jason being a supernatural being.
Yes.
Like, honestly, it's been so long since I've seen Friday the 13th movie, so I don't quite remember them all that well, but upon like rewatching this, it was so evident to me that this is just really leaning into this like supernatural being, but also it plays with you where there are scenes that you're wondering if anyone else actually sees Jason, or if it's just them, or if New York is just so disassociated that he's there, but no one gives a shit. So
I think it's that. I mean, I love the scene where they're running into the diner and they're like, someone's trying to kill us. And she's like, yeah, welcome to New York.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah. Even when he walks in, everyone's just like, oh, yeah. And it's not until he kills the first guy. Actually, that's like the bodega scene, actually. Bodega scene in Screen 6. And like, someone's trying to kill us. And they're like, yeah, whatever.
Well, what's interesting, though, when he pushes that guy in that restaurant, the actor he does that to is Ken Kazinger, who would go on to play Jason himself in Freddy versus Jason.
Oh, my God.
It's like Jason versus Jason. And now the universe has now collapsed upon itself.
It's on top of itself. Actually, no. Interesting about Kane Hodder. I've heard other people talk about this on the podcast, so this is not an original thought. He tends to be the most famous and most beloved Jason, yet he's in his films tend to be the least regarded out of all of them. Do you find this with Kane Hodder as Jason, or do you actually like 7 and 8 and X as much as... Well, I'm starting to love them more, but that is my own personal weirdness.
Well, I guess, yeah, well, I mean, I enjoy all the Friday the 13th films. Like, yeah, they all do range in quality, as you would expect a franchise would. But I think, yeah, I guess that does make sense. Like, Kane Hodder being the Jason actor that everyone associates that role to is kind of like in the lesser entries of the franchise.
Yeah, he which I find in Seven.
Seven as well, because that Seven was his debut as Jason.
Yeah, I think, especially like when you watch this, I think it has a lot to do with how he performs as Jason. You almost feel like there's something thinking in there a little bit.
Yes, actually,
he's not necessarily like that. So I just think that he's also like quite recognizable as an actor and performer and stuff. But I think because just rewatched this, he seemed to just bring something extra that I think makes him memorable. Even if the film is not the best, you kind of remember him, because at least in this, like, there are parts that are not memorable, but whatever Jason is doing, like, you take notice of. And I think that is credit to what he did with the character, who's literally just someone who doesn't talk and just murders people.
No, I think you're right. You can see him thinking, which is weird. There's something away about he holds his body that you can kind of see him, like, especially in Seven. There's a few shots, because I watched Seven on the last Friday the 13th and went, oh, crap, I think I do like this movie, which happens with every Friday the 13th with me. I just keep watching them, and then I'm like, no, I think I generally like this. But there's this way he kind of will just stare at people going, what is happening right now? Especially when every time Terry Kaiser's on screen and he's just looking at Tara going, wait, are you using a woman as a shield? Oh, well, kill her. But, you know, there's a moment where just the way he moves his body is very unlike everything else in the movie. Even if 8 is really patchy, and I know it is often considered one of the lesser Jasons, though on this watch, I kind of realized I like the stuff on the boat, but not so much the stuff in New York. And I think that's, I don't quite know why.
It's kind of patchy, and you can tell watching this, this isn't the movie that they wanted to make.
Oh, no.
Because the budget just wouldn't allow for the movie they wanted to do, so is pretty much just using a boat. But then how do you get from like Crystal Lake out into the ocean?
I suppose
there's clearly some way to get there. Maybe they passed Tromaville on the way with all the toxic waste or something. But I mean, it is evident like this isn't the movie that they wanted to make, but it felt like they did try to do something with, you know, what they could. So I appreciate it on that level. Like, I feel like they did make something that it's enjoyable. It's not fantastic, but it's an enjoyable, very silly Friday the 13th film that did try to do something different. It doesn't always land, but again, that's something I appreciate when you try to do something a little bit different.
Yeah, B, do you prefer the boat scenes or the New York scenes?
Yeah, that's kind of an interesting question. Like, I keep going back and forth, like, especially rewatching the film after so long. Like, what do I prefer more? Like, there are definitely stuff on the boat that I enjoy, but I do love the sort of the escalation once they do get to New York, because once they sort of realize Jason is still alive, they're basically on the run. So it kind of ends up being more like a chase film, in a way.
Yeah, no, I think I prefer the stuff on the boat, because this is a very unwieldy Friday the 13th, and a lot of Friday the 13th movies are very to the point. Jason's there, he's going to kill teenagers, and someone's just going to eventually out-survive him or get away, that kind of thing. And then once you get to New York, it does become a chase movie. Not to say it stops being ludicrous. I mean, the first thing that happens is they meet two guys, they kidnap the main girl and give her heroin before they attempt to sexually assault her, before Jason saves her. Yay, Jason. It's kind of this kind of weird escalating thing of what's the ultimate nightmare but New York. But the boat feels like more of a Friday the 13th movie that I want. You've got kids on a boat, they're being dicks, and Jason's just picking them off one by one. I mean, the boat sinking with the fire, it feels very much like a very climactic scene that then they just happen to add New York onto it.
Yeah. That's why it feels, I mean, I think it was the longest Friday the 13th film.
Yeah.
And it feels it because it's like, oh, we've got all this boat stuff, but we couldn't do more in the city, but we still have to do stuff in the city. So yeah,
it's called Jason Takes Manhattan. Yeah. He has to be Manhattan. Yeah.
So it's for me, it's some of the boat's good. Some of the city-ish stuff is good. But yeah, like with most Friday the 13th films, the characters you do want to see die because they're absolute fuckwits, and I can't remember her name, but she's like trying to blackmail the guy.
The teacher,
he's also the worst.
Down.
Oh, but I mean,
he is the worst, but yeah. Like, oh, you just want Jason to slaughter them, and he does. Yeah.
No, he does. I mean, that's fascinating. I mean, she's already, this movie kind of goes straight to 11 at some points because she's already doing cocaine. And then the movie just moves on to heroin. So it's just kind of like, going, whoa, that's just, we're not even going to do a pretend gateway drug here. Okay, cool. No one's got a bong. Awesome. Straight to the cocaine. Yeah, it's very unwieldy. It's kind of, once you get to New York, you're like, oh, well, shit, I've still got movie, because my favorite Friday thing, well, there's a too good a Friday made Friday the 13th movie. I tend not to like it like 4. Yes, I know that. I realize that's the best made Friday the 13th movie. But because of that, it's not what I'm getting, what I want from a Friday the 13th movie. It is just this kind of weird, unwieldy thing. So yeah, usually they have like 15 minutes of flashbacks and then you'll get into it. So most Friday the 13th movies are usually about an hour anyway. And then you've got another almost 40 minutes of them running around New York. Though I will say I do like the kills in New York. I think they're some of the best ones, like Julius getting his head punched off, or...
Oh, yeah.
What's his name? The teacher getting dunked in a barrel of toxic waste.
I mean, you don't get better than that.
No.
I had totally forgotten that this was the boxing fight scene film. Yeah. And all I could think of as I'm watching this scene is the Simpsons episode where Homer's a boxer and Jason's just standing there taking it like Homer is. And then Moe's like, oh, now you can knock him out. And Jason just like punches his head off with his one move. I just had the Simpsons in my head.
Yes. I mean, it's one of the famous Friday the 13th kills.
I don't know why I thought it was in a different Friday movie, but again, it's been years since I've watched them, so.
No, I tend to watch these movies regularly, so they all bleed together. Like, I'm surprised I'm not going, yeah, but what about the garden hacksaw that he's used? Oh, no, that's in 7. But Bede, you are going to be doing a mini-series on your Bede versus Living Dead. So do you watch these movies regularly, or...
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Like every few years, I'll sit down and watch them all because I am doing a spinoff to my podcast, Bede versus the Living Dead, with my friend, who's also Marcy's co-host on the King Zone's podcast spinoff called the King Zone Book Club, Stephen T. Boltz. He and I got a show together called Bede and Steve versus Camp Crystal Lake, where we're going through the entire Friday the 13th series, and as well as other aspects of it, like rip-offs, comics, the TV show, and so many others. So I'll be going a lot into Friday the 13th for a little while, but that's, to be fair, it is one of my favorite slasher franchise. So I guess with this one, though, I think what I find interesting, like, it is, you could definitely tell, like Marcy said, that this film was definitely hampered by the fact that they couldn't shoot more in New York or make more scenes in New York.
Yeah, because the budget just wasn't there for it. And the film was to basically have him in the city, at least from the background stuff that I've read on it, which I'm assuming is true because it really feels like that when you watch the movie. It's like, this feels like they wanted to make something else than the kind of making do.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate, but...
Which, to be fair, is a lot of Friday the 13th movies. I know after probably 5 and on, the American MPA was always cutting things out of them. I know 5 was considered quite violent. So for 6 and 7, they were just like, absolutely not. And time to get to the 80s, it's kind of the wind down of the slasher. So I think even Paramount was like taking money away from the movie quite excessively.
Yeah, I think even looking at this one, I think because all the previous Friday the 13th films, most of them were R-rated here in Australia. But I think around 7 and this one were actually rated M. So you could definitely tell, like, even this one in particular, even though, yeah, there's still violent scenes in it, but it's not as bloody as other entries in the franchise. But one thing I will give this film a lot of credit for, even though, yeah, the script definitely feels very half-baked, because it obviously had to be rewritten so they could have most of the film take place on a ship. But I think Rob Hedden, who, you know, this was his directorial debut, one of the things I was really surprised about when I rewatched this film is that he actually brings a lot of interesting filmmaking elements to it, and he even brings some surreal moments to it as well.
Yeah, and that kind of leads into that heavily kind of supernatural stuff with the main character, Rennie?
Rennie,
keeps having visions of, like, child Jason, who looks very different than he did several other movies ago.
Well, that's pretty much the thing of this franchise. They tend to retcon or change
the thing from film a little bit. So with that, like, some of those moments actually kind of catch you off guard a little bit. And it is, I mean, for the most part, because it is a little dark off of the ship, but it's really well shot. It's at least on the boat section, I think it's lit really well. We can see things. I think some of the cuts, because we don't necessarily see full on with the kills, I think it works because it feels a little bit more gruesome. But I will say this about the ship part, is that we do get, I think it was the debut of Kelly Hu.
Yes.
Yes.
And I'm sitting there thinking, that's her? Wait, she was in this? I was like in denial. I didn't think it was actually her. Then I looked it up and was like, holy shit.
No,
I don't remember that at all.
No, it is her. I mean, the Friday the 13th movies had kind of been pushing this guy supernatural from six. Like, they had the cool Frankenstein homage when he's kind of taken up from the dead from lightning, and that's when he kind of becomes zombie Jason, I guess. I've seen these movies way too many times. And then seven, he's kind of under the lake, is a zombie, and he has a psychic connection with Tina. I don't know, why is Tina such a bad name? I hate it when final girls are called Tina. This in Halloween 5, I'm like, stop calling them Tina. And sorry to Tinas, I don't know why I have this thing against the name. Which now I actually kind of like that movie. But, and then this one, he's again woken up because someone is having sex on a boat right above where he is. I think it's something to do with the anchor, but I'm like, nah,
he's electrocuted.
He's electrocuted with the anchor, but it just also happens people are having sex. So,
which I still think it's
the whole thing just resurrected him or whatever.
Yeah, he could sense teenage hormones. Because by this stage, it was very much Jason, even though that's not particularly what the series ever was, this is the time when everyone just associated, oh, Jason kills teenagers who have sex. So it's kind of been this buildup of this kind of supernatural kind of being, because it's only so, which happens with most slashers. You either have to keep changing them like Scream, or they end up becoming a supernatural being. I mean, how many times has Michael Myers died only just to come back in the next movie? It's like, you have to, anyway.
I mean, at least the plus with Freddy is he was already a supernatural being.
Yes.
So they just thought of weird ways to, like, resurrect him again, like a dog pissing on his bones.
Well, one thing about Jason being supernatural, especially in this film, this really does cement the theory that I think Jason definitely is a teleporter. Because, like, he can...
Oh, yes. He teleported inside a building upstairs.
The scene with Kelly, who's deaf, like, she will kind of go to one side. He's, like, there, then turns around, he's there, and there. It's like...
That's because he's a supernatural being with teleportation powers.
Yeah, he's literally Nightcrawler from the X-Men in this movie.
not that they had to, like, keep cutting because they ran out of budget. So we'll just have him, like, one end of the boat, and all of a sudden he's, like, in the captain's thing, killing everyone in the captain's kind of quarters. He's just completely supernatural. But poor Kelly Hu deserved a better death than being strangled in the air. But it was a good place to die. I do like that really random empty ballroom, because there's only like about 10 people on this massive boat wandering around. But
And for a boat that's only just going to New York, they have plenty of stuff on there. They got like a discotheque. They've got like clay shooting. They have like curling. a sorta.
Yeah, but like, why are there like only 10 of them there? You'd think it was a whole class of like 30 or something. Again, there wasn't money in the budget for more people.
I had to laugh when basically like there was other students in there, like maybe 5 or 6 other students.
Oh, yeah.
And then they, who were just random, like the extras in the movie. Mm. And then it's like, oh, we got to go back and get them. And it's like, oh, the boat's blown up. We can't get them. It's like, it barely even blew up. You can go back and get them. You just didn't give a fuck about
this. The line's amazing. I actually made a note of it. It's like, oh no, I left the students in the restaurant. We have to go back and get them. There is no restaurant.
it does have silly movies. And I think my favorite like kill in the movie is with that purple guitar.
Yes. I wish it lasts longer. I liked that because I think it sort of set up an interesting dynamic between her and the camera guy. Like, yep. I could go, oh, I want to know more about that. But then she's taken out straight away. And then the other guy doesn't make it off the boat. So
yeah, it's the unfortunate thing is that she does cark it early, but is a very just bizarre way to murder someone with a purple electric guitar.
Hey, Jason's going to murder you with what he has on hand. That's what I've always admired about him. He's not fussy. He will just take whatever's at hand and kill you with it. Exactly.
And I think that's, again, like you were saying before, Lindsay, about what I think makes Kane Hodder such a memorable actor as Jason is. Of course, he says a lot through his body language, and particularly with probably another little moment that's one of the most famous moments in the film is when he comes out of the water, gets on the dock, and he looks up and he sees the giant's, like, the sign of his mask.
Yes.
And he's like going, huh?
His little head tilts are like when the dogs do head tilts because they're trying to like understand you. It's kind of adorable, little Jason.
Yes. I don't want to give him a scratch behind the ears like I do when a dog does it. Like as soon as the dog cocks its head, I'm like, oh,
no, he's a good Jason.
Well, speaking of dogs, we got to say that the best actor in the entire film is Toby the Border Collie.
He's a good boy. Toby's a good boy.
Although he has the right idea. Once they get onto the dock, he just pisses off. And then it's like, nah, I'm out of here. See you later, bye.
That dude that attacks Rennie, like, almost shoots him. And then he's like, nah, this is a fuck this shit o'clock. I'm going till Jason's dead. So lo and behold, he comes back later.
I know. But I was like, where did the dog come from?
I love that the dog is credited. It's Ace. Yeah. And it's got his own credit in the thing. It's very nice. It was a good doggo. And I like when the dog doesn't die.
Exactly. Because there's a lot of movies where I'm just like, I've been watching a bit of Ken Loach lately, which is nothing to do with this. Because he's a different filmmaker. And animals, I mean, people don't do well in his movies, but animals, oh my God, it's okay. Life is pain and misery and okay, I get it. But but the thing is when they get to New York, it suddenly turns really mean. And I'm talking about a slasher movie, which I know and inherently mean. And Friday the 13th even has moments you're like, oh, that's mean-spirited. But something about as soon as when the main Remy gets to New York and she's kidnapped, assaulted, and forced to heroin. I'm like, dude, what is, it's just.
And it's like all in the span of like five minutes.
Yeah, 5 minutes. Mm. It all happens in 5 minutes. And so the rest of, it's just so, I mean, then when Jason comes like, yeah, kill those fuckers because they really deserve it right now. But it just is a lot in a short space of time. And then it just turns into this chase movie when I associate that more with maybe Halloween. I don't know. The New York parts don't feel like a Friday the 13th movie.
Yeah, they do feel more like appropriate in Maniac Cop, like in that series. Yeah.
Yes, I expect a poor woman to get assaulted, forced heroin, and is assaulted in Maniac Cop. That would be fitting in with that world, and then Maniac Cop would turn around and just kill everyone involved, including the poor victim. But this feels weird, and which I love the fact that Marcy chose Scream 6 as a trailer because they were able to go, okay, so Ghostface is a very suburban slasher. Mm. He lives in the suburbs. He hides in between houses. He's kind of hides within plain sight because he's always someone the character knows. But to transport him to the city and make him work, I think was actually I think it's a big achievement that people don't necessarily recognize because slashers are kind of part of their environment. It's like putting Michael Myers in the city, I don't know, would completely work either. Mm. but you'd have to write it in a way where it makes sense. Because again, Michael Myers is a creature of the suburbs. Jason's a creature of the wilderness, and they kind of needed a way maybe to make it a little bit sensible. But again, they had to write the script really quickly. They had no money, and they probably had a really tight shooting schedule. So it was sort of more of a feels like on the fly. But in saying that, I do like some of the shots, especially when Jason's on the train. I do like seeing that shot of him just walking, stomping toward them. And
no one gives a shit. Like,
and no one gives.
And that leans into what I said. Like, can people actually see him, or is that just the attitude Marcy, of people in New York? If you're on the train right
at night, you're tired, and you see this guy in a hockey mask stomping down the aisle, you're not going to really do anything unless
I would probably be frozen in terror. I mean, look, we see a lot of weird shit on the trains, that's what I'm saying. In Melbourne, but
unless something is really imminent violence.
I mean, it's more like you kind of hide your face kind of thing. But these people just reacted in no way. It's like, you're not scared that there's like this like very,
I don't know, unless he
liquidy looking hockey mask wearing probably stinky person.
I would say unless he had his machete, I wouldn't bat an eye. Like, if he's just stomping down there, I'm like, yeah, whatever, he just wants to get home. I'm just not going to make eye contact and hope I don't get involved. If he's got the machete, then I'm going to be frozen in fear because I'm like, oh, okay, violence is about to happen. But the amount of times I've been on the train and I hear a ruckus and I'm just like, okay, as long as you don't stop the train, I'm fine. I just want to get, no one's hurt. I just
stay away from me and we'll be fine.
Because we'll be fine. Just get to my stop and we'll be fine. So that I actually kind of get, which sucks, because I think there's this weird thing when you get on public transport is you just get into your own zone. Mm. You don't want to look at anyone because the people who talk to you on public transport, you don't want to talk to. So actually that doesn't surprise me, to be honest. Unless there's a machete or a weapon involved,
he kind of was the weapon.
Yeah, he is the weapon.
In that regard. Yes. But yeah, I think because, you know, a lot of this takes place on the boat, there was no real time to kind of set up Jason being in the city. And yes, I feel like they just kind of didn't really know what to do without really showing the city, except for the shot where he's like in Times Square. And that's pretty much it.
I mean, they spend a long time on those shots and
they tried to make, you know, any like the 5 minutes of footage they had in the actual city, we get in the opening credits, we get in this third act, they really milk it. But I do feel like there wasn't really much of a way to set it up. And it also feels like New York should have a lot more people around. This felt very quiet for a lot of stuff, except on the subway, even just being in like that Times Square, it just felt a little bit quiet. Not that I've been to New York to be able to tell, but at least that interpretation we get, it's like a very big bustling city. It's known as the city that doesn't sleep. Why did it feel like everyone was sleeping that night? Because there's like nobody really around. So that kind of puts you out of it a little bit because you expect there to be a lot more people around, but
again, you have to pay the extras. So I get that. Every single thing is like, oh, wish we could have done that. Yeah, but they didn't have the money. And the one thing I love about kind of this kind of filmmaking is that you just work with what you have and you kind of hope for the best. And when we get to even, oh no, there's quite a few people mulling around in Central Park in Muppets Take Manhattan. So no, I lie. There's actually quite a few. They have actually quite a lot of people in that. That's a bustling New York. Okay, forget I said anything. But no, it is. I mean, Friday the 13th are always kind of what they are. And this kind of marks the change, because after this, you get Jason Goes to Hell, which is a weird ass movie I actually really, really enjoy, because it doesn't have, well, he's in the first 5 minutes and then his soul is possessing different people. And it's kind of amazing where it goes. Actually, if that ever pops on Tubi, that'd be an amazing Tubi Tuesday. I know. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that just the shaving scene alone would be.
Although, wasn't after this movie, didn't New Line get the rights to Friday the 13th?
Yeah, which is why they're no longer Friday the 13th, and why we only have had one remake. So it's Jason Goes to Hell and Jason X, or Jason X. I always call it Jason in Space, but it's actually not called that.
Jason X.
Jason takes space.
It should have been.
Jason, I mean, at least he actually took space in that movie.
Yes, he is actually in space for actually all of it. Yeah, but he does. But he, even if I think this movie's unwieldy, I think it does. So I do feel a little bored a few times in it. It does give me all the Jason I expect, and Kane Hodder is still very good at being Jason. He's fantastic at being Jason, actually. Anything else you want to say about Jason Takes Manhattan before we move on to The Muppets Take Manhattan?
I guess one of the things I like about the film, especially, is the opening, how it kind of establishes New York.
Well, the narration is kind of funny.
Yeah, the narration is fun. Oh, sorry.
I thought you froze for a second.
Okay, I think it was me, yeah. So yeah. I'll say that again. Basically, yeah, that weird radio announcer and stuff like that. I don't know why this radio announcer and all of New York are excited that a bunch of high school graduates from Lakeview High are coming to New York. I don't get it. But anyways,
and there's five of them.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. I like how basically every time we talk about how many students are on this boat, it gets lesser and lesser.
It gets less and less. But it's funny because that opening, like, it's this very, oh, it's going to be in New York and stuff. And then you're let down when you're like, oh, this is going to be on a boat for most of it, isn't it?
But what I do like about it, like, again, against the sense of the city, but at the same time, everything that appears in that opening scene comes back later in the movie.
It was
like
the five minutes of footage they managed to film.
I mean, that is true, but it's that's beside the point.
They focus way too long on the rat and the toxic waste, and then you see the rat dead, and it's like, oh, poor rat. They didn't deserve that. But yeah, they do. You can kind of tell that they're like, when they get out of the subway station and they just look around Times Square, it's almost like they're awed, like, oh my God, we're actually in New York. But they spent ages going around every single ad. It's like, yeah, no, they're using every single piece of footage they managed to get. They had like a day or even probably a night, and this is what they did. And it's like, you're seeing it. This is where the money went. It was on filming in that one night in New York.
Exactly.
Pretty much.
Yes.
I will add, the soundtrack is pretty cool. I grooved a bit to the soundtrack, so I give them props for a nice funky 80s sounding soundtrack.
Yes, I would have liked to see Purple Guitar's album. I think she would have been very fun. Mm. It just reminded me of Camp Rock, how she's playing this really cool riff. Oh, she's this riff. And I'm like, yo, madam, your guitar is not plugged in. How is this happening?
Magic.
And with that, we're going to go on to a movie that spared no expense, because this was Jim Henson, probably at the top of his game, or many that were actually, no, he didn't direct this, Frank Oz did, because he was too busy doing a lot of work for The Dark Crystal, or doing something when they were making this. So yeah, the curtains are going to open again, and we're going to be getting into the magic of Jim Henson. Bede, what is going to be your first trailer for The Muppets Take Manhattan?
I'm actually going to go a little obscure with my trailer of choice for this film, because I figured I need to pick something that is a family film. So I picked an animated film from 1997 that actually was a bomb when it came out, but it's kind of grown a bit of a cult following over the years. And that, of course, is the 1997 film Cats Don't Dance.
Turner Feature Animation introduces you to some new characters you'll love. In a story that could only happen in the movies. It's about a cat named Danny. He's got a dream. He's going to Hollywood.
Hollywood, where the streets are paved with gold.
And he's ready to dance his way to the top. So join Danny.
I guess we're going to be the only two cats on the ark, huh?
Sawyer.
So much for preserving the species.
Tilly.
I hear hippos are very, very big on Broadway.
They're big everywhere, darling.
Wooly. And Pudge.
Uh-oh, I'm busted.
Along with all of their incredibly hilarious and entertaining new friends. And Darla Dimple, child star extraordinaire.
I am an angel.
I have not seen this.
Cats Don't Dance is an interesting film because
I have no idea what this movie is. I kind of feel like I have to look it up.
Well, it's actually set in an alternative 1939 where a young cat who's voiced by Scott Bakula decides he wants to become a big movie star, and he goes to Hollywood to make it as an actor. And so he gets there, and pretty much this is a world. this is kind of a precursor to Zootopia, where, you know, like how the film Zootopia used animals as subtext for racial discussion. This film kind of does that, but in 1930s Hollywood.
Hmm.
And so it pretty much wants the character of Daddy, who's voiced by Scott Bakula, gets to Hollywood. He tries to do his best to be a big major star, but unfortunately, though, the big Hollywood studios only put animal actors in small animal roles rather than the big lead. So he and a couple of other animal actors decide to find a way to become the stars of a film. And to me, this why I picked this film is because, like Muppets Take a Manhattan, it's a bunch of characters who come to the big city to make it big and some of the struggles that they have along the way. And it's also a musical, so it actually features songs by Randy Newman. And also, some of the dance choreography was actually supervised by the great Gene Kelly for this film.
I would also like to point out that David Johansen plays a bus driver from the New York Dolls. Well, Don Knotts is in this movie.
How George Kennedy is also in it, but also it has one of the best villains in an animated film, at least the most underrated villains. It's a character named Darla Dimple, who's kind of like this cross between Shirley Temple and Norma Desmond. And she's like meant to be like this cute child star, but she is absolutely evil. And she and Ashley Peldon does the voice of her, and she is fantastic in it. And it's a delicious, great villain character.
I feel like I need to watch this movie.
Me too.
I have not heard of it. I looked at the cover and I'm like, I don't know if I even saw that cover, like at the video store or.
Nope. This is not ringing any bells.
I think it's just I think Warner Archive just released it on Blu-ray.
Oh, because it is Warner. It is Warner Animation, like, which was, this is 97. Is it 97 or 87?
Yeah, well, the thing is, like, this movie cost like $32 million at the time to make it. It only made 3.5 at the box office. So it was a massive bomb. But it has developed but it actually did get good reviews and is now kind of become like has a bit of a cult following behind it now.
Okay, well, I must discover this cult because I did not even know this existed. I was like, wait, did Gene Kelly do the choreograph? Oh, he died the year before it came out. Okay, that makes sense. Yeah. Wow. Okay, I need to. Yeah, I'd never heard of this movie. This was 97. So what? This is when Pocahontas is coming out and Anastasia around this time. So this movie had no chance.
Yeah, well, but the interesting thing is because there's like this award show called the Addie Awards. This is like basically the Oscars for animated films and TV shows. And it actually won Best Animated Film, beating out a lot of big contenders that year. So it definitely has its fans, this film.
Okay, yeah, okay. This is going on the list. I need to watch this.
But I think if you enjoy like golden age of Hollywood films like from the 30s and 40s, particularly like the big musicals and that, I think you'll definitely get a kick out of this one.
Okay, yeah, it's on the list. It's done. It's on my watch list. I love when people bring up movies. It's only an hour and 15 minutes as well. Even better. Awesome. Marcy, what is going to be your trailer for Muppets Take Manhattan?
Look, I changed my mind my trailer. I originally was going to say Fame.
Which I'm still going to put Fame!
Because, you know, that is, you know, they're at the performing arts school. It's kind of, you know, like about making it in the city and all that. But I thought, you know what, I've changed my mind. And my trailer is not family friendly, as the movie is not, but it does have puppets. My trailer is Meet the Feebles.
A motion picture that breaks with convention. Disregards taboos. Risks 90 days in jail.
Feeling shy, are you, Blanche?
This is a family show, for Christ's sake.
And digs deep into hitherto unexplored regions. This is such a picture.
Oh, that's beautiful white fur.
God.
The barriers are down. Sex.
I'm hot, Fletch, but not the way you think.
Drugs. Animal husbandry.
Why did you bring it here? It's not mine. You know it's not.
We'll let the court decide then, shall we?
Corruption.
Barry, do me a line.
From the killing fields of Vietnam to the playing fields of Beverly Hills.
Oh, what the heck?
This is the motion picture that dares to probe the secret innermost fears.
Yes.
It is also a musical. It also has puppets, but it is disgusting. And what a movie that is. And that was one of our earlier movies we did on the Tubi Tuesdays podcast.
What is the Sodomy song? Sodomy, everyone. Yeah, I can't remember.
I cannot remember the songs at the moment for the movie, except Meet the Feebles.
Well, it also does take like, even though, yeah, it's a TV show, but it's also a stage show, from what I remember in the film, so it makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, they're still performing in something. It's the behind the scenes of
this adult
it's like Muppets backstage for the adult audience to see.
Yes.
It's the seedy side of the puppet world.
They filmed it in the one of the main theaters in Wellington, if I remember correctly. I cannot remember. I want to call it the St. James, but I think it's the St. James. God, I've worked opposite it for years. If this is a rite of passage movie in New Zealand, you'll either get shown this or Braindead. And usually this is the one that made everyone uncomfortable because there is a song about sodomy, which is great. And also one of the characters contracts HIV and gets AIDS. But no, it doesn't turn out to be that. But he makes snuff movies. I don't know. This movie's wild.
It is wild. It is disturbing. It is fucked up.
Yeah.
And we're very thankful to Peter Jackson for the weirdness of this movie.
Well, yes. Also, like, it's a good pick as well, Marcy, because I think the now recently cancelled Muppet TV show that was on Disney Plus recently actually acknowledged that Meet the Feebles is in the same universe as
it
the
is. No! It is actually they exist in the same universe
because Peter Jackson makes a cameo in an episode.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, because like it was a show. Like I haven't watched it yet, but I've heard good things about, which is a shame why it's now been cancelled.
That's because Disney cancels everything.
The
bastards.
Yeah, because the Electric Mayhem, the Muppets band, and they had an episode where Peter Jackson was on it, and he pretty much like they talk about the time about Meet the Feebles and how that movie for Peter Jackson was actually he was making a documentary.
Yes, no! it's totally canon. And it kind of, we have like some of the characters kind of a little bit Muppety, but
pig,
in different ways, like Heidi the Hippo.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, she is a hippo.
So, yeah, in the end, I decided to go with Meet the Feebles.
No, I love this as a trailer. I love this movie to death, even though I'm not entirely sure how I feel about it being in the Muppets universe, just because I'm such a Jim Henson Muppets kid. I'm going to need time to process that. but no, I think this is a fantastic movie. This is a movie that shouldn't exist, and yet it does. And I love it forever that Peter Jackson has such a sick sense of humor that he looked at the Muppets and went, you know what I'm going to do? Rabbit with HIV.
Pretty much.
Yeah, and I think it's kind of one of those movies you go, I did not know you could do that with a movie. And you're watching this, you're disturbed, you're elated, you love it. It's got an infectious kind of thing about it. It's and maybe get an infection from it. I don't know. This movie's pretty skeezy.
It is very dirty.
It's so dirty. It is. Yeah. But no, I love this idea as a trailer. Okay. So for my final trailer, I think I'm going to go back to family friendly. But with a much more, I'm going out of New York, but this is a much more well-known and everyone's going to know this movie, unlike Cats Don't Dance, but I am going to go for the very famous Pixar movie. I'm keeping a rat theme going on, if you haven't noticed, but I'm going Ratatouille.
I'm
And tonight, before the dessert course, we present for your pleasure the traditional cheese trolley. To start, we have an excellent clochette, creamy, very nice, very light. Next, a brebis, hearty, with a surprising bite, I think you'll find. And finally, the pièce de résistance, a very special, very rare.
This is me. I think it's apparent that I need to rethink my life a little bit. I can't help myself. I like good food, okay? And good food is hard for a rat to find.
It wouldn't be so hard to find if you weren't so picky.
I don't want to eat garbage, Dad. What is that?
I don't really know.
You don't know. And you're eating it.
You know, if you can sort of muscle your way past the gag reflex, all kinds of food possibilities open up.
Yes. Brad Bird, Pixar, 2006 or 2007. Yeah, this movie's charming. It's about a rat who wants to cook. And so he puppets a man. I don't know how the joke in Everything Everywhere All at Once with the raccoonie,
yes.
Yeah, is going to age well. But I love it. I love it to death. I think this is a movie about following your dreams and finding a different avenue that may not be what you thought, or not, and also not being defined by how others see you. I think Patton Oswalt plays the rat, doesn't he?
Yes.
I think he's charming, and I don't always find him charming. And yeah, no, this is a fantastic. I haven't seen it for so long. I need to rewatch it, but I just remember it being really beautiful. And like other Pixar movies, it just makes me cry.
It's a great movie, and yeah, it is a really good pick to go with it because it does have the puppetry aspect.
Yes.
But it does have the, you know, kind of follow your dreams aspect, which Muppets Take Manhattan does as well.
Yes.
Well, let's not forget we also.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, rats working in a restaurant.
That was
well.
My go ahead. Marcy's too was very smart and noticed the puppetry thing. I was just like, rats in the kitchen. There's a movie called Ratatouille. Abid, I'm guessing you like this movie. I haven't come across anyone who hasn't actually. Even people don't like Pixar.
Yeah, I do love Ratatouille. I haven't seen it in ages, but it's definitely one I need to go back and revisit. But I did remember loving it a lot, and especially because the concept is such a good one. And I also love that, you know, you have Peter O'Toole as the food critic.
Yes.
And he's wonderful in that film. And yeah, it's just a great film, and I honestly would not have picked it, but now it actually feels appropriate for the film we're about to discuss.
It does. It really does. It works very well.
All those trailers have worked really well, and I cannot wait to see Cats Don't Dance and go, this is perfect. This is adorable. And with that, we're going to be getting into an absolutely charming and berserk movie, because you cannot have a Muppet movie that isn't charming and absolutely berserk and weirdly horny at the same time. And that is, of course, Muppets Take Manhattan.
New York. Times Square, Broadway, all the lights, all the spectacle, all the excitement. Thousands come every day dreaming of one thing, to make it to the top. Out of these thousands, one has a very special dream, and he's got something unique, something ordinary people don't have. And together with his friends, he's gonna take this town by storm.
Taxi? Taxi?
Creep! The Muppets Take Manhattan. Coming soon from TriStar.
Now, I know Bede has just had a birthday, and you're only a few years younger than me, I think.
Yes.
Are you a Muppets kid?
Oh, totally. Actually, it was funny, though, because I was first introduced to the Muppets via the Muppet Babies, who actually make their first appearance in this film.
Yes.
As well. So, I think that was pretty much where the genesis of the show came from, was, of course, this scene in the movie, because audiences responded so well to that
they
little scene.
They are fucking cute.
Have you seen the Muppet Babies? They are adorable.
I also loved Muppets and Muppet Babies and Sesame Street growing up. I was very much a Jim Henson child and childhood as well.
Yeah. Yeah, because we're all about the same age. So there's always, you can always tell someone who was born in kind of the early 80s, late 70s, and if they adore the Muppets, you're like, yeah, you were raised on Sesame Street, you were raised on the Muppets. I was probably introduced to it probably first with Sesame Street, I think, and then started watching the Muppets and went, what is this madness? Because you forget the Muppets wasn't actually a kids show. It was a normal variety show from the 70s. So their jokes could get very bad, a lot of innuendo and a lot of blue humor, which I really appreciate. Like, I was watching an old episode with Christopher Reeve and all the rats are following him around just like flirting with him. And I think it's adorable. Apparently the first episode where Rizzo shows up. So yeah, so Marcy, had you seen Muppets Take Manhattan for a while before you watched it for this, or is this something that maybe been sitting back in your memory, or you'd never seen it before?
Oh, I saw it when I was a kid, but I don't think I'd seen it since. But when I put it on to watch it, like, the whole opening just like flooded back with all the memories. So I was like, oh yeah, like, I remember this. I wasn't sure if I'd remember it very well, but it was like, oh yeah, I remember this like very well. And there were some parts of it that I was like, oh yeah, I remember this very well. I had actually forgotten until it came up that this was the start of like where the Muppet Babies came from, because I still love the Muppet Babies.
Yes.
So that again, like, that's a great scene, but there's just a lot of zany things in this film. And I laughed so hard at Miss Piggy and Joan Rivers just going insane on, I'm pretty sure they had cocaine beforehand.
Miss Piggy included, yes.
Yes. In the makeup department at the department store. And I don't know what it was, but it was great.
It was so funny. I kind of thought I'd seen this as a kid, but then watching it, even the Muppet Baby, and I loved Muppet Babies. I, in fact, had this doona of Kermit and Miss Piggy as Muppet Babies. And my biggest sadness is when I was a kid, our house got robbed and they took my goddamn Muppet Babies doona.
What?
Charles Muppet Babies doona. Seriously. I love that doona. But yeah, so I was watching it going, I don't think I've seen this. I thought I had, because I thought I'd seen everything kind of Muppet related, because I know I watched the original Muppet as a kid movie over and over again. So I'm like, I know I saw Great Muppet Caper. How did I not see this until the wedding scene at the end? And then I'm like, oh, wait, it's all coming back to me. I definitely remember those two getting married. I remember Kermit and Miss Piggy tying the knot on stage. Or whether they did, or now I'm realizing they may have all been a production and Kermit still...
Well, Miss Piggy did put in like a celebrant as a last second replacement from Gonzo. So potentially she tricked him into the marriage because Kermit is such a, like, a commitment phobe.
Yes, he's always kind of keeping her on a string. Like, and you don't realize until you watch it later, like, he's toying with her and he's like, I love you, but don't get too close. No commitment.
He's like very nervous about the commitment.
And Miss Piggy's just like, come on, we need to get this thing done, and she swaps it. I like to think, no, they are married now. I think it is canon that those two are married, or are they still on and off?
Exactly sure. I have to look it up. So
actually, look it up. Yeah, Bean, had you seen this as a kid? Because you brought it to me and said two words, Muppet Babies, and I was like, yes, please.
Well, I'm pretty sure I did, but I don't think I probably saw it like I don't think it was one of the earliest Muppet films I saw. I know. The Muppet movie obviously would have been one of the first big Muppet films I watched. Yeah. I think this was definitely probably later, around 10 or 11, I saw this film. But I don't know what it was about this film, but I've always been very partial to it. It's not like my favorite Muppet film. I think The Muppet Christmas Carol is my all-time favorite Muppet film. But this one I've always had a lot of fondness for, and I'm not sure why that is, but I think it's just such a fun, joyful film. And again, it deals with, you know, following your dreams and trying to make the best of what you got and just doing whatever it takes to get there. I think those are themes that, you know, when you're young, they do resonate with you. And also, it's just a really funny film. And one of the things I sort of realized watching this film, you're right, though, Lindsay, like, there is a lot of bit of adult humor in this film.
There's a lot. And
these are raunchy, horny Muppets, and I am here for it.
I kind of like tend to forget that the Muppets wasn't like for kids. It had that balance of humor that you could watch it as a kid and certain things would go over your head. But like watching it back, it's like, we really got to watch this stuff as kids.
I mean, Gonzo giving Camilla the chicken mouth to mouth and then going, I think we're married now. And his eyebrows just go wiggle, wiggle. Just like,
Or even like when they're all hanging out together and Janice, one of the members of Electric Mayhem, pretty much says to one of the Muppets, she's like, so I told him, listen, buddy, I don't take my clothes off for anybody, even if it is artistic.
Good for you, Janice.
And I'm like, what about, like, maybe it's because I associate, like, you know, when the Muppets, you know, were bought out by Disney and they kind of tone all that stuff down. But yes. I'm like, I keep forgetting, like, they really did some raunchy jokes. Like,
yeah, Jim Henson had
these early films.
I think even Jim Henson said, I've got Seth the Sesame Street guys, they're for children. They're the children's Muppets. Over here, they're running a boarding house. They are just absolutely freaks. We get to really, we don't have to play by childhood rules with those ones. And it's kind of weird that because we all grew up with them, that they are our childhood, they are so totems of our childhood thing. And just on a really depressing note, I did look up to see if Miss Piggy and Kermit were still together. And Kermit denies that they were married and says not even romantically involved. A clip with Piggy follows that she expresses that they're married in their hearts and she's still working on the rest. And this is like from recently. And I'm like, oh, Kermit, come on. You have a good woman right there. Yes,
exactly.
Yeah,
Kermit, you need therapy, buddy.
You need therapy. Okay, yes. Does she go full Jason Voorhees in Central Park? Yes. she has boundary issues. I understand that, but
Miss Piggy is insecure. She's very insecure. She has jealousy issues.
Much jealousy
you
issues.
You know,
yes.
She does do a bit of Jason Voorhees-ing. These two do have, like, there's a bit of the stalking aspect. When I spoke to Bede the other day, you were like, well, they've like graduated from something and they go to the big city.
Yes.
They start off the same. I mean,
they both start off exactly
on a boat, but you know,
they both do start off exactly the same. Yeah. And when I watched Muppets Take Manhattan, I was like, holy shit. Like, these two movies kind of start off exactly the same.
So they get to Manhattan way quicker. And then the movie is in Manhattan.
I mean, they do split up and have to go work to earn money in all different locations. And I don't know what some of those jobs were, but...
Oh, my God. The Muppets. One with... Oh, I can't remember. I can't... Rover. Who's the dog?
Ralph.
Someone needs to take away my Muppet card. I forgot who Rolf was. But his scene, the fact that he's working in a pound, and when James Coco walks in, I was in stitches, like... James Coco is one of the funniest men on the planet and he is gold in this. But Miss Piggy going boys in the park is, as soon as I see her like stalking the binoculars, I was losing it because I love the scene with Joan Rivers because it's just them having fun. It's not Joan Rivers being snarky, which I think she kind of gets known for. She's just like, you know what, I'm with a cool girl, let's hang out, let's just be stupid. And she's putting makeup on Miss Piggy. And yes, I'm referring to these as real people because they are real people. The Muppets are real. I don't care what anyone says. Yes, I know Frank Oz voices Miss Piggy. It's just a really sweet scene of two people hanging out and I love it.
Oh, yeah. And I think I think my favorite cameo in the film is when Gregory Hines pops up, like, after the post-chase. And I can always say, that burglar being chased by Miss Piggy on roller skates, that's actually a frightening image.
Because they've got a poor child in a friggin' pig mask and a wig going full bore.
That
down
felt like an adult grown person, because Miss Piggy looked massive compared to puppet form. It was freaky.
Yes, but when Gregory Hines shows up and he gets in between Kermit and Miss Piggy having an argument, he's like going back and forth between like, it's like, wait, you gave your friend the huggies? Oh, it's like, it's and it was just
Kermit was hilarious. Totally flirting with Julie. He just got totally caught out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Although, like, there's definitely cameos in this film. Like, I did remember, like, Gregory Hines, I knew Brooke Shields was in this film. And her and Rizzo bring up Into Species dating at one point, which is. But I also forgot, it's like, John Landis has a cameo in this movie.
Yes.
I forgot about that. And, like, I think it's Elliot Gould just shows up for a second.
Yep. Liza Minnelli.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's kind of amazing. My favorite has to be right at the beginning with Dabney Coleman.
Yes, just that was a great cameo.
That scene is amazing. The way Animal is kind of, when they realize they're being scammed, because they're like, wait, they're getting a contract already? This doesn't happen. And then you've got Animal just all four legs on the door going, bad man. It's like bad, the greatest man. Thing ever.
And speaking of Animal,
yes,
got my little Lego Animal. Can't see too well on the camera because it's a bit blurry, but I do have something to show you both, but continue because I got to go find it first.
As much as I do like Animal's a bit skeevy in this film because we introduced to him chasing after a woman in that auditorium while they were performing.
Well, to be fair, he does that all the time.
Oh, yes, he does. Apparently,
he has aged out of that and is a bit chilling out. I don't think he just completely chases women. But yeah, in the 70s, he was, known for that kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. But I think that's one of the things about this film is, like, I guess I was just so, like, taken aback by all the kind of adult jokes because, again, like...
Caper and the original Muppet movie are rife with them. Yeah, it's amazing.
Oh, yeah, especially because, like, what is it? Miss Piggy and Charles Grodin, of course, have an actual relationship in Muppets, the Muppet Caper.
As you should do, because it's Charles Grodin.
Exactly.
I love that you just, like, full on. Like, that's what I love about these movies is that everyone take. I mean, that's what I love about Christmas Carol is that Michael Caine is playing Scrooge seriously. He's taking this world as it is, and so does everyone else in these movies. But talking about full relationships, when you find out that Miss Piggy and Muppet Treasure Island is totally screwing everyone in the cast, is especially Tim Curry is amazing. They treat it like, which is why you think of these characters as real. Like, as soon as you put in, is Kermit dating Miss Piggy, and then it's got this like byline of things they've said. And I like living in a world where these were Kermit the Frog and the rest of the Muppets are real. Like, I haven't even seen the Big Bird documentary because it's about the guy who's in the Big Bird suit. And I'm want to know about the guy. Like, he's amazing. And I know it's a really great documentary. But I just want to live in a world where there's Big Bird. That's what I want.
Yeah. That seems to be the kind of the reaction everyone has when they meet anyone from the Muppets or on Sesame Street. Yeah. Is they kind of like, you see them and you act like they're real people.
Yeah. There's a guy underneath, but you just don't focus on that. You're focusing on the actual kind of thing. And that's a little bit of the genius. Though I will say, this is, I think, Frank Oz's first directorial effort. Like,
He co-directed The Dark Crystal, but this was his first solo effort.
Yeah. Oh, did he do so? Okay, because I thought that was just Jim Henson. Because Jim Henson was always in control. So this is the first time that Jim Henson went, okay, Frank, you can go off and do your own thing. And I will say, I think Frank Oz would go on to make much better movies. And it's not my favorite out of the other two are the other ones, other Muppet movies, purely because it feels much more piecemeal. Like, you're just jumping from scene to scene, skit to skit, which is usually fine because those individual skits are good. But then when Kermit's in the restaurant, I'm suddenly thinking of Bowfinger and I'm like, oh, I could be watching Bowfinger right now. Like, but you can see these sort of seeds of what Frank Oz is going to do in his later movies, like with, the Killer Plant one.
Little Shop of Horrors.
Little Shop of Horrors, or in Bowfinger, you can kind of, even in the other Steve Martin one with, where they're playing con artists.
Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. Sorry, I'm just blanking on everything. But you can kind of see where he's going to go with Muppets Take Manhattan, and it's kind of the more of the promise of it. But in saying that, I giggled throughout this movie. Every time you saw Miss Piggy like stalking Kermit, I thought it was just the funniest thing ever.
Oh, definitely.
Because
definitely.
It is. Because it is.
Because it's really, really funny.
Because she's our Piggy.
Yes.
Yeah, she's icon a lady. For a reason.
Yeah, she's a lady.
And I may or may not be able to do a pretty decent impression of her, but I will save that for later.
Well, yes. I mean,
you kind of got to do it now.
Yeah.
Oh, so, okay, hold on. I got to get into character.
Just think of Louise Lasser.
Okay.
The two arms.
It's not Louise. It's Miss Piggy.
It's Miss Piggy. Oh, sorry. Now I'm very self-conscious now. Anyways, give me a second. You cannot resist what...
Oh, shit, that is good.
Shut up, frog. I can't do it.
Yeah.
Kirby-Doo frog. Kirby-Doo
all right,
frog
so here. Do you want to see... Do you want to see what I have?
What do you have?
Now, these are very special.
Yes.
It's, oh, my God. Is those the McDonald's...
Yes. It is the McDonald's Muppet Babies.
I Happy Meal have toys. Those. Oh my God.
I have all five. I Kermit sent you both. I sent you the close up photos. It's Fozzie on the horse.
Horse. And then it's Gonzo on the tricycle.
Little animal. in the little whatever that thing is.
And cart.
And Gonzo on the bike.
Oh my God. Those are so special.
I know. And they're just packed away because unfortunately once Freddy got a hold of one and ate it and I had to buy a replacement.
Freddy!
Naughty Freddy.
Naughty Freddy.
Okay,
Naughty.
Since we're kind of talking about the Muppet Babies at the moment, we have to figure out who out of the Muppet Babies sequence, who's the cutest one out of all of them?
I don't know. Scooter, maybe. He's adorable.
I like baby Gonzo.
Gonzo is cute.
Gonzo and Animal are like my favorite Muppets. So it's probably them, but they're all very cute. I will say, I was kind of mortified at the beginning of the movie where poor Camille, is it Camilla the chicken?
Yes,
gets fucking strangled. That was not okay. I felt for her.
Yeah, but that's okay because Gonzo goes from mouth to mouth and they're now married. Actually,
if you want to see...
Also, let's not forget...
If you want to see my other cool Happy Meal, by the way, I have DuckTales.
Oh!
Scrooge
McDuck.
I forgot her name.
Oh,
Daisy.
No, it's not Daisy.
It's not Daisy, Doc.
It's Willow or Winnie or something.
It must be. I've got the boys...
Huey, Dewey, and Louie.
On the jet ski and I forgot what this dude is on the plane.
Oh, Launchpad McQuack.
Yeah, I can't remember all the characters' names because I'm like kind of sick and
Yeah, Launchpad McQuack is definitely the one in the
Yeah.
And I have a spare little Gonzo scooter.
Yes.
But yes, they are. These are my prized possessions.
They are.
Need a special cabinet to like keep these all in.
But I was going to say, like, speaking of risque humor, and like the scene where, like, I've forgotten the character's name too. I have to look this up. Fozzie is
one of my favorite. I love Animal. I love Gonzo. I love Kermit. I love Piggy. But something about Fozzie just makes me happy. Waka waka waka.
Exactly. But also, like, there's this, like, he goes to hibernate, and basically, it's like a female bear. It's like snuggling up against him.
Wouldn't you? Although, speaking of Happy Meals, do you remember these guys?
Oh, yeah.
No, those I don't.
These were definitely released in Australia.
Oh, wait. I remember. Yes, no, I do. I do remember the one with the yellow hat because I had that one. I remember that guy.
Yeah, these are like Happy Meal. I have a bunch of Happy Meal toys. Anyway, I'm going to stop with that.
That's amazing. Oh, and Gonzo and Camilla have been in a relationship since 1979, and they are still together. So, yes, that makes me happy.
So take that, Kermit.
Kermit, you need to get over your commitments and make an honest woman out of Miss Piggy. Thank you very much.
Exactly.
Yeah, Kermit, you moron.
Yes.
But also, speaking of Fozzie, I don't know if it was just me, but
he looks
like...
weird without a hat.
He does. He looks like
I can't
like
look
balding.
At him. He looks like he's naked and you shouldn't see him like that.
Yes, his head's weird and pointy and I don't like it. I don't like it. He needs to wear a hat. The hat and the bow tie. It's how Fozzie needs to be.
Yes, exactly.
Take off the hat, buddy.
No, never take off the hat. You need
But
the
also,
hat.
Like, this entire, like, the Manhattan Melodies, which is the musical that Kermit and the gang are trying to put on Broadway, like, that whole entire final sequence is great. Like, it's really well choreographed with the songs and everything. But it's also like, it's also one big kind of plan for Miss Piggy to finally get Kermit to kind of commit to him as well.
Wait, is that the thing that they, because he's been saying there's something missing, we need to rewrite it. Is the wedding the thing that he's talking about?
No, he's more about getting more Muppets in the show. Because there's also a subplot in this movie, which I completely forgot about, is when basically Kermit has like a Harry Osborn kind of situation where he basically gets into an accident and loses his memory. And then he goes to work for an ad agency, which is run by...
I totally forgot that was part of the movie. And then when like he goes into their little area and stuff, I'm like, I remember these characters and I remember them going to the diner and stuff. And it's weird how I just remembered parts of this movie, but not all of it.
No, I didn't remember that, but I was giggling. I'm like, what movie are we in now? Really, Phil? And then, of course, Miss Piggy does her famous karate chop, and then he remembers who he is. Because that is, of course, what happens in anything Muppets. No, it's kind of weird, that thing, because I'm like, what movie are we in now? But I do love the joke when he's in the hospital and the nurse is like, since you did not have any clothes on, I started researching nudist colonies in New York. And is your name something Rodriguez? He's like, no, I don't think so. And he's like, oh, well, then we can't help you. You can leave now.
And
it's
like... And also, like, the frogs at the agency are named Bill, Gil, and Jill.
Yes. Why wouldn't they be?
Because, like, since Kermit doesn't remember his name, like, he thinks his name is... He makes up the name Phil, so...
It's very, when you're talking about it, you're remembering all the things like, oh yeah, this is great, oh yeah, that's great, oh yeah. And the whole time when I was watching, I'm like, I could be watching Bowfinger, because Bowfinger rules. But then I'm like, no, I could be watching the Muppets, because this absolutely rules. And even though, yeah, no, I'm only just realizing that you're right, this whole movie is being a ploy for Miss Piggy to try and hook into Kermit, because when they're on the carriage together, she's like, before you get into the whole Muppet baby sequence is so she can go, what if we knew each other when we were young, like if we were just like together all the time. And then the whole song, Kermit's in the background doing his own thing.
I mean, I don't know how determined Kermit was to get Manhattan Melodies like on Broadway, because he did say to Miss Piggy, once they get it on, they'll have enough money to get married, and he still doesn't really want to marry her. So
that's why she has to put it in the musical.
Yeah, that's why it's in the musical. I don't know what's wrong with Kermit, why he's like that. Miss Piggy is a gem.
She is. She's an absolute gem. Okay, yes, I realize. No, she has boundary issues, but they can work through that. I mean, it's fine.
Although,
to be fair, though, I think basically it pretty much summed up that, like, Kermit is definitely more into humans. Since his relationship with, like, Jenny was like, they're like, yeah, they're friends, but it's like, you know, if they spent more time together, they could easily be a couple if they wanted to.
He went jogging for the woman. I mean, he was definitely into her. Like, that is a thing. Though it was kind of, I do love the diner, how you go in and how the whole joke is that there are rats everywhere, but they work there. And of course, it's Rizzo and his crew. That is absolutely adorable. And then the fact that they had to go back into the kitchen because everyone was upset that they were getting served by rats. So every time you go in the kitchen, you just see all these rats like wandering around. And I very much enjoy that. Like, and they're just like going, you know, that whole diner thing. I don't know. There's something about magic. As soon as this movie starts, I start smiling because I'm like, okay, I'm with the Muppets. Like, this is awesome. I love the Muppets to death.
Yeah, it's a chance to be with the Muppets. It's It's a story we've seen before. It's nothing all that new, but it's fun because it's Muppets and just how kind of everything plays out, and the Muppets that, you know, get more focused on. It's to their strengths as the characters they are. But I did mark out a little bit during the Manhattan Melodies with the wedding with the Sesame Street crew being there.
Yes.
Like I forgot they like appeared and I got very excited.
I know. I mean, when you see the Sesame Street crew, as soon as I see Big Bird, I'm just like, and Bert and Ernie, I'm just like, yes.
Yes.
And Cookie Monster, I'm just like, yep, this is my happy place. Cookies. This movie is just really fun. And the fact that they filmed in New York, this is obviously a production that had a lot of money and time because you're dealing with puppetry and you're dealing with puppets on bikes. Like, this is a thing with all the movies that like to show off that whole thing. So it's a very technical movie. It is set in New York. Like, they actually go to in Central Park and they film all around there. They're actually on the streets of New York. Obviously the diner is a set, but a lot of it is actually running around New York, which is so cool. Like, it's kind of, it does make a difference when you're actually in New York. I don't know what it is, but this is nice New York. This is like Broadway New York. This is not going around 42nd. Actually, no, that's 42nd Street is Broadway. It was around Broadway. So it's kind of weird how one end is like completely skeezy and the other end was like Tony's.
Let's not forget also Statler and Waldorf are also in this movie to chime in with their commentary of things. And I think
because
I got the quote here, and one of the jokes of them say is like, oh, well, Waldorf, they finally made it to Broadway. Yes, and I brought tickets. Are they good seats? Sure are. They're on the next train out of town. Which made me laugh a lot with that.
Yeah, since they couldn't heckle, Fozzie, they had to heckle Kim and Miss Piggy.
But it's just a sweet and charming film. Like, I think, maybe it's not the absolute best Muppet film, but it does have a lot of charm. Yeah, but it's still just a fun, joyful film that's just got so much sweetness and charm. And whenever the Muppets are on the screen, you just can't help but be, you know, transfixed by them, and also just get, you know, invested with the story because they're such likable characters. And again, like, even though, yes, we all know they're puppets, but we kind of treat them as their real flesh and blood beings.
Well, I love how they are. This is a society. We've just said, no, they're flesh and real beings and they have actual lives and everything like that. I mean, I think the one thing I noticed with this, and also with Great Muppet Caper, is that because I love the songs. I mean, I love the songs in, a great deal of the songs in Christmas Carol. So that's kind of, but enough distance has passed. Because Paul Williams did the music for the first one with Rambo Connection, I think we got a bit spoiled with that. So the other two movies have never hit it with the songs for me, but only because that first movie, just the songs were so good because, of course, the great Paul, I think it's Paul Williams, wrote the songs, and you're just going, oh my God, Rainbow Connection is just one of the greatest openings ever, which is Kermit with his banjo singing with the Rainbow Connection. But in saying that, it's more about just the gags and the jokes and what everyone's doing when they're writing letters to Kermit, and how Kermit's sort of more, he wants to keep Broadway. He wants to go to Broadway because he can keep the gang together. It's not because he wants to go to Broadway. It's because he wants everyone to stay together. And that's kind of his, I like how that's his goal. It's so everyone can stay together. So the band can stay with the band can get back together. And I really love that.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. That seems to be like something that they've been doing for most of the films.
It's how do we keep everyone together so we can be a family, which I never get tired of.
Well, I got to say this before we go on, because we were talking about the amazing Miss Piggy and Joan Rivers scene. I'm just reading some trivia on this scene. And according to IMDb, it says here, after several less than satisfying takes of the scene between Joan Rivers and Miss Piggy, director-performer Frank Oz sent a stagehand to get him and Joan Rivers two gin and tonics apiece. The two chatted and and drank their drinks before filming one take, which appears in the final film. So obviously the take we see in the film is Frank Oz and Joan Rivers being absolutely shit-faced on screen.
Yeah.
As it should be.
You can tell. You can tell.
And it's actually, and it's fun drunk. It's not the, oh no, Richard Burton's drunk and trying to put out a fire with a crutch in Exorcist 2. It's no, these guys are actually having fun.
Exactly.
Yes. anything else you want to say about Muppets Take Manhattan?
I'm just trying to think. I think we've covered quite a lot on the film.
Yeah, I mean, it's a movie that has a lot going on, but it's all piecemeal. So there isn't like a connecting, massive connecting thing.
There's a lot of just oddball scenes, which is like what the other Muppets are trying to do for work. I don't know what Gonzo was doing with his trying to be like Evel Knievel or something. Doesn't quite work out well for him. But everyone writes Kermit like these positive letters, but they're clearly hating like their shitty jobs by themselves. There's those little bits like that kind of break up the movie, and you know, I feel like it flows along really well. It's just a fun, enjoyable movie.
Yes, and weirdly not on Disney Plus. I was kind of shocked about that.
I think it was Columbia Pictures owns this one.
Oh, is it because of the Muppet? I always thought maybe it was the Muppet Babies, but is it because I was like, wait. Yeah, because Disney just tends to buy up everything so it doesn't have to come up with a new property.
I think I know based on what I'm reading right now, I think Universal Pictures owns The Great Muppet Caper.
Oh. And
I believe I'm just sort of looking up, and I think they own the other, but oh, actually I think Columbia Pictures also owns Muppets from Space, and I think all the other ones are owned by Disney, I believe, because I think the last time I was on Disney Plus and looking in the Muppet section, I believe all the other films outside of Muppet Caper, Take Manhattan, and From Space were on there.
Oh, that makes sense, because I know that Disney tried to buy them before Jim Henson died, which is kind of one of the tragedies of Henson's death, and he went absolutely no way. This is owned, I own this, I can do what I want. I've got a particular vision for the Muppets and no one's going to change that. And of course, after he died, that's when they swooped in and went, can we buy the Muppets? Oh yeah, Great Muppet Caper isn't on there either. Oh no, it is. Yes, it is. But it's way, way down. I love the Muppets. I think, there's nothing like them. And there's continued to be nothing like them. I think they are something uniquely special that I'm so glad we have in the world, because it just makes you smile every time you watch them. Even when you're like going, it's not the best Muppet movie, but then you're like, I don't care. It's a Muppet movie.
Exactly.
And this has Muppet babies. Let me be clear. Muppet babies. It's like too much cuteness.
It is. It is.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for coming on for this double. It has been absolute blast as normal. I love catching up and hanging out. Before we go, Marcy, please tell people where they can find your good work.
Thank you for having me on the show. It was a blast to talk about these movies and the trailers. You can find the Super Network and all the podcasts we do at supermarcy.com. You can look up the Super Network on your podcast feeds, on your social feeds. You can find us pretty much everywhere. And me personally, I'm available at Super Marcy on all the socials.
Excellent. And please do, because she does amazing work over there, especially with the To Be Tuesdays, everything else, the Stephen King Book Club, everything like that. You do so much. Both of you do so much. I sometimes lose track. Bede, can please tell people where they can find your good work.
Well, of course, you can find, you know, all the awesome podcasts I do with Super Marcy on the Super Network, on all podcast streamers everywhere. In terms of my solo stuff, you can follow both Bede versus the Living Dead and Bede and Steve versus Camp Crystal Lake via the Bede versus the Living Dead podcast feed on all podcast streamers everywhere as well. And when it comes to social media, you can follow me on Twitter at twitter.com/BedeJamide. I still refuse to call it X, but that's just me. but also you can
Don't
follow.
Call it X.
Yeah, exactly. You can also follow me on both Letterboxd and Blue Sky under Bede Jemine as well. So people can follow me on those too.
No, and please do. It's a great follow. And yeah, Schlock and Awe's in all the pods. You can follow Schlock and Awe 1 on most of the socials, and also Reading Geek on things like Twitter and Letterboxd. And yeah, we will be back with another 20 episodes next month. And also, we will be back with another double feature next week. All right, thanks, guys. Bye.